Welcome in, everyone. I'm the real John, and while 2022 was full of great movies, that doesn't mean there weren't plenty of stinkers, too. So, let's say goodbye to 2022 with... Deer and Projector Lights Bottom 10 Movies of 2022. Number 10. You ever get to the point with a creator where you've seen them make so many bad things that you begin to question if they were ever good to begin with? Pay no attention to the Nostalgia Critic clips playing. We're talking about Rebel Wilson. I wasn't aware of Rebel Wilson until the Pitch Perfect movies, and I wasn't a fan of those, so I never really got into her brand of humor. She seemed like if Amy Schumer had an Australian accent, and this movie kind of put the nail in the coffin for her in my mind. Not that the gimmick behind this movie's premise was great anyway, but it's just so obnoxious that I could never fully enjoy it. Even before being played by Wilson, I thought Stephanie was a terrible, unlikable character, and if Angourie Rice, who's shown good comedic chops since she was 14 in The Nice Guys, couldn't save Stephanie, Rebel didn't stand a chance. And when this movie isn't being obnoxious, it's being boring. Coming-of-age stories can be done well, but it just isn't done well here. It's completely color-by-number screenwriting. The script may as well have been a Mad Lib. It so closely follows the same tired tropes. I think the worst part is this movie has great comedic supporting cast, but they get nothing from this script. It feels like such a waste. Number 9. This next entry has two movies, because they're from the same series, but mostly because it's just the same damn movie. Seriously, the titles may be different, but there's no real difference in terms of anything of substance. Both movies are just a series of montages set to bad strip club music that sometimes detours into bad acting and screenwriting. What little story there is here doesn't elevate above a mid-tier soap opera. I can't even get upset at the movies at this point. They're just too stupid to know any better. And yet, despite this whole series being based on literal kidnapping and Stockholm Syndrome, it still expects us to give a shit about these personality-devoid cardboard cutouts maintaining a relationship. Why? Even Bella and Edward had more personality than these nobodies. Why should I care if this openly toxic relationship continues or not? All I can say is to whatever earnest fans there are of this series, because for all I know, the only fans it has are the ones who like it ironically for how bad it is, you seriously deserve better. Number 8. I'll say this for the two 365 Days movies. At least they were just boring to watch, unlike this shit, which was just infuriating. Both of these last two entries are what I like to call homeopathic Twilight. I call it this because, like in homeopathy, each new IP is just a dilution of the source IP, i.e. Twilight. And also like homeopathy, these are all utter bullshit. While the 365 sequels got boring after a completely reprehensible premise, the after movies have only managed to showcase ever more toxic aspects to a relationship. Seriously, what is there to even like about Harden other than he's hot? Besides being really, really, really ridiculously good-looking, why would anybody like this guy? He's abusive, he's violent, he needs to be in therapy and actually deal with his issues. No amount of sex or romance will fix his emotional trauma. You can't solve people's mental health problems by dating them. On top of the Chernobyl-grade toxicity of the main romance, the story is just so terribly written. It's just a prolonged will-they-won't-they of Harden and Tessa getting together and breaking up the whole time. There's nothing else going on in this story other than Harden being pissy about his parents not giving him enough attention as a baby or whatever, and he takes that out on Tessa, who, despite clearly capable of doing better than him, just can't get enough emotional abuse and threats of violence in between hot makeout sessions. Also, that name is the dumbest shit ever. It's not happily ever after. It's after ever happy. Seriously, that kind of shit is a cure for imposter syndrome. If this shit can be called after ever happy and get released, then at least you can do better than that. Number 7. Very few movies make me feel like I need to shower after watching them. This movie was one of those rare few. If you're in more literary circles, you may have already heard of Joyce Carol Oates' fictionalized take on Marilyn Monroe's life, Blonde, and how it leaned hard into the more lurid and controversial aspects of her life to the point of exploitation and arguably even degradation. So when you have that as the source material, it's no wonder we got such a miserable movie. Blonde is one of those movies that's more like an endurance test. How long can you watch this movie treat its protagonist with abject misery and abuse before you tap out? I managed to make it through, but it took me having to stop and start the movie 2 or 3 times. And that's before you get into the treatment of Monroe herself. Oates admitted her book wasn't intended as an actual biography, which only makes me ask why she even used Marilyn Monroe's name instead of just making up a new character whole cloth, you lazy. But even as a fictionalized version of Monroe, you can't imagine the filmmaker had anything short of abject hatred of Monroe to subject her to such misery for almost 3 goddamn hours. Like, why? What's the point of basically torturing this woman for the whole length of the movie? Because if they were trying to say something about the nature of stardom or Hollywood or whatever, they're really bad at it. I think the saddest part is this movie and the book it's based on only end up adding to the mistreatment of Marilyn Monroe. Like, I'm not gonna sit here and tell you that Marilyn Monroe's life was all sunshine and rainbows. Obviously that wasn't the case, but so much of her image has been run through the ringer, twisted and contorted into any number of shapes, even from when she was alive. From being the pinnacle of female beauty, to a shameless harlot, to an inspirational figure of feminine power, the icon of Marilyn Monroe has been used and abused for other people's purposes for so long, and this movie just adds on to it, dragging a dead woman's name and image through the mud and exploiting it for their own gain. Even in death, Marilyn Monroe never finds any peace. The only thing of merit to give the film is Ana de Armas' performance, and while it's good, it's never worth sitting through the slog to watch her portray this facsimile of Marilyn Monroe. Not only has she given better performances in other roles in other movies, there were countless better performances by actresses last year. Ahem. Just don't even bother with this one. Number 6. This will be the 5th of the last 6 movies I discussed on this list being from Netflix. Remember when Netflix originals had some shine on their name, some level of prestige? Now hearing something's a Netflix original makes you clench up and expect the worst. You know who else makes me expect the worst? Kevin Hart and Marky Mark. They make plenty of bad movies separately, so why not put them together? What could possibly go wrong? This movie is another endurance test. Only this time it's in how much of these two jackasses you can stand before tapping out. I remember Mark Wahlberg had some decent clout as an actor. Back in 2013, he was in 3 movies that I really liked. Now he shows up and I know I can just expect to see that one sketch from SNL about him for 90 to 120 minutes. Kevin Hart isn't any better. He's been doing this manic man-baby shtick for the last decade and it's worn thin. He was fine enough in the League of Super Pets movie, but even there, he was clearly not the best voice fit for Ace. He was only there because it was him and The Rock together on another film. But even if you had likable stars in this movie, it wouldn't make it any better. I wouldn't have hated it, but it would have just been a lot more forgettable without Marky Mark and Kevin Hart. You could point a gun to my head and demand to know the plot of this movie, and I still couldn't tell you. Shit just happens, and Marky Mark and Kevin Hart are annoying the whole time. There was something about this kid wanting to do a hackneyed stand-up special for a talent show instead of playing the keyboard like his dad once, but that's never really ironed out or interesting. As far as I know, there wasn't even a script for this movie. They just got Marky Mark and Kevin on the set and turned the cameras on. We're going to take a bit of a break from Netflix in the next few entries, but this won't be the last of them on this list. Number 5. When the original Disney Cheaper by the Dozen movie came out with Steve Martin in it, it was a bit of a sticking point for my high school theater group. Not a serious one, but we were putting on the original story of Cheaper by the Dozen, which was based on an autobiography of two of the kids of engineer Frank Bunker Gilbreth. It's actually a really charming story, which did get its own movie adaptation in 1950. The Martin version has nothing to do with that source material, and is honestly more akin to something like Full House or The Brady Bunch, a safe, family-friendly comedy about having a lot of kids in one home. I never watched that version of Cheaper by the Dozen, but from what I've seen of it, I probably wouldn't like it. That said, the Steve Martin version looks better than this remake. This movie was the first entry I put on this list, and it managed to make it the whole year. We're even further away from the source material, and what we're getting in return is even lazier and more creatively bankrupt than the Martin version was. Zach Braff and Gabrielle Union have no real chemistry, there's no plot to speak of, and while making the family mixed race could have been interesting, they only address it once throughout the whole movie. So the one thing this movie could have had over its predecessor is barely addressed. Instead, it manages to just be another soulless cash-in on the name recognition, which seems to be the only thing coming out of Disney these days. Number 4. Jesus, I'll say this for Blonde. At least it had Ana de Armas. This shit didn't even have that. Based on another controversial novel, Redeeming Love claims to be based on the biblical story of Hosea, which itself was just a metaphor for the relationship between God and the kingdom of Israel, with Israel being the promiscuous woman Gomer. Yes, that's her real name, that Hosea, the stand-in for God, marries, and each of their children representing some aspect about the northern kingdom of Israel. It's not all that romantic, and taken literally shows Gomer in a very terrible light as this unfaithful wife, who even bears Hosea a bastard son because she sleeps around so much. Not something you could really make into a steamy Harlequin romance, you know? Let alone a Christian one. And yet, that's exactly what someone tried to do in 1991. And for some reason, we finally got an adaptation of it! And if you thought Blonde was a misogynistic movie that just abuses its female protagonist the whole time, this movie comes up and says, "Hold my beer." The main girl, Angel, starts her life being abused by her own father, sold to a pimp as a child prostitute, constantly gets molested, and worse, by every single man in her life until she runs away and is taken in by an honest Christian farmer who basically just treats her as if they're already married and she's his property. She's then treated by the writer as less of a woman because she was told that she can't bear children, tells her husband in a letter to marry a 13-year-old neighbor girl because she can't bear him children. Said 13-year-old marries the husband's brother, who is a grown-ass man. But then Angel comes back to serve her purpose as a woman and bear him children, despite being told she was never going to be able to do it. It's a Christmas miracle. The After and 365 Days series feature terrible relationship dynamics based on abuse, but apparently all they need to do is say that that's how God and Jesus say it should be, and a good chunk of American Christians would eat it up. Like, even Michael, the only decent man in the story, never actually cares about Angel as a person. He only wants her because she's hot, and then he expects her to conform to the role of a Christian farm wife even before they get married. The dude isn't romantic or caring, he's just another dude who sees Angel as property to be controlled, and the movie says the best she can hope for is that at least her owner won't actively abuse her. And then Christians wonder why people are leaving the fold when this is how they think relationships should be. Number 3. Of the inexplicable 3 Pinocchio movies we had in 2022, one was really good, one wasn't great, but at least had some decent parts to it, and one was a steaming pile of shit. This movie came right the hell out of nowhere, and if you weren't online at the beginning of the year when the trailer for this started making the rounds, it was insane. I mean, for one thing, what's Pauly Shore doing here? And what's John Heder doing here? Was this casting done via dartboard? Even if they did get a decent voice cast, which the international dub is apparently out there and kind of better, slightly. The dub script itself is still terrible and makes no attempt to lip sync to the animation. The animation is par for the course for direct-to-video animation, honestly, in that it looks impressive for 2000s TV animation. And the character designs are just not appealing at all. And while the story of Pinocchio usually deals with coming of age and learning what it means to be human through wacky adventures, this movie completely loses the plot and just meanders through the Cliff Notes version of what people know about Pinocchio. I think the worst part is that it's not even bad enough to be fun. There's a certain point where a bad movie inadvertently becomes fun, with things like The Room or Troll 2, and from the trailer and clips, it looked like this could be one of those movies. But instead, it's just tedious and flat. Watching an actual children's puppet show would be more engaging than this movie. For the longest time, this was the very bottom of my list for the year. Then I finished catching up on movies, and it managed to only be knocked down to number 3. So what could be worse than this? Number 2. Let's go back to our friends at Netflix, where we got yet another absolutely wretched romance movie. But this time, they got politics involved. Based on another romance novel, Purple Hearts tells the story of a progressive woman who works as a bartender and a conservative Marine who shows up at her bar with some fellow Marines before leaving for Iraq. Sparks fly as their politics continually clash against each other, but because the woman is diabetic and struggling to afford insulin, the Marine agrees to enter a fraudulent marriage with her so she can take advantage of military spouse insurance.
How romantic.
The rest of the movie is full of all kinds of bad tropes and contrivances, from the fully expected liar revealed about their marriage, terrible writing for both the progressive and conservative characters when they argue with each other, and you can tell the writers have no idea what the actual arguments between the two are about. The addict owing a dealer money trope that doesn't amount to anything, and one of the worst attempts of the enemies to lovers trope I've ever seen. I'll admit, I'm a filthy communist, and I find it hard to connect with conservatives when our values are that far apart, but it's not unusual for couples to have some differences in political opinions. But you can have a couple with opposing political views. The thing is, there have to be other things that attract them to each other besides the politics. And here, the only thing they have going for them is the willingness to commit fraud so a diabetic can afford insulin. I think that's the worst part. This movie dances around a lot of major issues, like the cost of insulin, addiction, the human cost of waging war, but they never face those issues head on. They're just like,
yes, very sad. Anyway,
hell, these issues might serve as the common ground for the couple, but they never write that into the script. It's just expected that the two get together because the writer said so. There's no deeper thought to it. Which begs the question, if they weren't going to actually say something about these issues, why would you bother bringing them up? Plot dressing? We have one more movie to go, but before that, here are some dishonorable mentions.
You don't think I'm a bad person?
This one wasn't as bad as the listed entries, it's just, I have no idea who this movie is for. It's too gory for a traditional YA audience of teens, not to mention it's rated R so they can't actually pay to see it. It's not gory enough for horror fans, and aside from the visceral cannibal scenes, the story is just kind of tepid and uninteresting. Who would want something like this? This is another one that wasn't bad enough to put on the list proper, but I just really can't with Jimbo's Smurf Cats. Not only is this just a recycled version of the plot from the first movie, it actively retcons two major deaths from the first movie, meaning those deaths have less weight now. This whole franchise is all looks and no substance, but those looks are enough to keep this franchise going since this movie was able to at least break even with its $2 billion budget. But that just means we get to see the Fire Nation show up next time. Joy.
on airplane mode.
Oh, Roland, I don't know how you keep getting studios to let you make movies. They're never any good, and this one isn't even bad enough to be fun. It's just pathetic.
It's nasty.
Cause we are...
Roderick rule number 10. Always go out in a blaze of glory.
Susan! Oh, see, I can't unsee that.
This one was on the list proper for a good while before getting bumped off. I wasn't into the live-action Diary of a Wimpy Kid movies, but I at least got the appeal of the books. These animated movies, meanwhile, looked stiff and lifeless, and while they utilized the art style from the books, it managed to be a lot less fun than the actual live-action movies, save for the last one.
Who the hell are you, Matt?
I am Venom.
I'm just kidding. It's Dr. Michael Morbius at your service.
The movie's so bad it bombed twice, because Sony mistook an internet meme for genuine interest. This was also on the list proper for the longest time before getting bumped down. Also, how the hell did Adrian Toomes get his Vulture costume if he was the only thing that came through the MCU portal? Like, did he make a new one there in the Venomverse? God damn it, Sony, can you just stop f***ing around?
Please, I don't want you to go.
This was a late entry that quickly got bumped off the list proper, but it's basically on the same level with Senior Year in that it's an obnoxiously unfunny comedy. But ultimately, Senior Year was the worst movie for me, so I let this one slide as a dishonorable mention. Sucks that this is what Menemutsud has been relegated to, since he was by far the least of the Aladdin remake's problems.
Who knew an evil army could go through so many beams?
What the mother father cocker spaniel's going on here? I
like your respect. Paws of Fury, The Legend of Hank.
Time to finish this.
This might take a while.
And the last dishonorable mention is the train wreck formerly known as Blazing Samurai, a bizarre, kid-friendly animated remake of Blazing Saddles with dogs and cats in feudal Japan. See, you chuds, this is what happens when you try to make Blazing Saddles today. Are you happy now? Number one. As I mentioned, for most of the year, Pinocchio: A True Story was the worst thing I watched. It wasn't until the end of the year catch-up binge that I did, where I found two movies to surpass its badness, and both of them came from Netflix. It feels like almost overnight, Netflix went from a prestige destination to a dumping ground. What once was home of Academy Award-nominated films and Emmy Award-winning TV shows has become the home of direct-to-video-grade trash, bad reality shows, and controversial programming because getting talked about for being bad still means you're getting talked about. And this year, over half of my bottom 10 were Netflix originals, culminating with this absolute travesty. I'm not even much of a Marmaduke fan. It was a simple single-panel newspaper comic. There just wasn't much interesting about it. It had this short-lived Saturday morning cartoon alongside Heathcliff and that bad-looking Owen Wilson live-action movie that I never watched. And then Netflix dropped this steaming pile into our laps. Starring Pete Davidson, David Koechner, and J.K. Simmons, this assault on the senses would have just been another forgettable family comedy, rife with the cheapest and lamest pop culture references and body humor to carry it. But for some reason, they decided to have the ugliest, most off-putting character design I have ever seen from an animated movie. The ugly dolls in the Ugly Dolls movie weren't as ugly as this movie. Nothing about this movie is appealing. Not the humor, not the animation. There is no redeeming quality to this movie. The only good use I could see for this movie is as a means of torture, which should be considered a human rights violation. And there you have it. Those were the worst movies I saw in 2022. We'll just have to wait and see how bad 2023 will end up being. So, until then, I'll be seeing you.